Welcome, welcome everybody to Friday night virtual cooking class. So, you know, a little bit of a plot twist here in New Zealand, and you know, we found ourselves in a place that we have been before, but luckily we got each other, right? And so we are going to be hanging out for about an hour this evening, and you know, just providing a little bit of entertainment and lightheartedness for your Friday night, and just, you know, inspiring you. So if you already have a Thermomix in your kitchen, hopefully we're going to inspire you to create some of these dishes at home. If you don't have a Thermomix yet, well, hopefully you're going to see how amazing it is, and you're going to walk away wanting to add one to your kitchen. Probably you'll see how much fun all of us are having, and you might think you want to be part of that fun and you want to join our family, and that's great too. But yeah, we're just here to be of service to you tonight, and so we hope you have an amazing time. My name's Odette Smith, one of the business development managers for Thermomix in New Zealand. I'm in Beachlands, East Auckland. I take care of Southeast Auckland, the Waikato, and the Bay of Plenty. And I am what you call a raving fan. I fell in love with the Thermomix late 2017, decided I just had to have one. We're about 5 minutes into that cooking experience. And once I got it home, I just fell more and more madly in love. 2 or 3 months later, I was at a cooking class, an in-person one, because that was pre-COVID. And I just decided that, you know, I wanted everybody to have a Thermomix and it looked like heaps of fun. And so I joined the team. For me, initially, it was a side hustle. I'm an optometrist, but it very, very quickly grew. And I actually decided to give up my job as an optometrist and focus on Thermomix full time, which I'm actually pretty pleased about at the moment, because optometry, not such a great thing for doing from your house, but Thermomixing, totally an income that you can create for yourself while you are in lockdown. So that's a little bit about me, and I've got some of my amazing team leaders and consultants who are going to be helping me cook tonight, and I'm super grateful to them. But this is what's on our menu. So what we were thinking about when we designed this class is that lockdown looks a bit different for everybody. So some people like me, you know, I'm eating my feelings at the moment, right? I want it to be delicious and decadent because that makes me feel better. But some people, they've decided they don't want to add any extra COVID kilos. They actually want to keep it fresh and healthy during lockdown. And so what we want to do is give you a few recipes that you can easily adapt to either be healthy and fresh and nice, or to be a little bit delicious and naughty. And yeah, hopefully you're going to take some inspiration. So this is what we have got on our menu. We are going to go pizza two ways, either a cauliflower and ricotta pizza base, or we're going to go deep dish pan pizza with some delicious toppings and cheese. Then we're going to go turkey burgers, and we're going to give them to you two ways, in a brioche burger bun or in a lettuce bun, a bunnace, apparently that's what they're called. We're going to go summer fruit crumble with crème anglaise, and we're going to give you a healthy option for that one too. It's a summer fruit compote with yoghurt. And then last but not least, we're going pina coladas, which either could be, you know, a healthy pineapple smoothie if that's where you want to go with it, or otherwise you can put a little bit extra in the, and that's what it's going to look like. So before we start, what I'd love to know, and I'm just going to launch a little poll because I do love a little poll, is what is your lockdown going to look like? Is it going to be naughty or is it going to be nice? So feel free to vote. Let's see what everybody thinks. And while that is happening, I'm actually going to stop sharing my screen. And we're going to start the cooking. So for those of you who haven't been on Zoom before, down the bottom left corner, there is a mute button, and it is best to mute yourself because otherwise we can all hear what's going on in your house, and that's a bit embarrassing. Up the top right-hand corner, you can change your view. You can either be gallery view, which means we're all in little boxes, or you can be speaker view, which means everyone sees the person who is speaking or cooking. So that would be my recommendation, speaker view. Down the bottom, we have a chat box. So guys, the more chatty you are, the more fun it's going to be, the more, you know, we're going to tailor it to you. So ask lots of questions. I'm very good at keeping an eye on the chat box. So if you ask a question, I will answer it for you. But yeah, we're going to have an awesome time tonight. And as I said, we're going to be together for about an hour. And, you know, we're just really excited to offer this service to you. So for those of you who have hopped on with two friends, you are going to get host rewards. Yay for you. So if you came with two friends, reach out to your consultant straight after this Zoom and say, hey, I want my stuff, right? And it's going to be real cheap stuff. And if somebody decides to make the very wise investment of a Thermomix, it's going to be free stuff. And we know free stuff is the best stuff. And, you know, hopefully it's of service. So the poll, we have had 71 people who have answered my poll. 58% of you say that they're going to be naughty, and only 42% of you say that you're going to be nice. So that's interesting. Let's get cracking. So first person who is going to be helping me cook is the lovely Jodine and her assistant Steve-O. So Jodine, how about you introduce yourself and then you can let us know what you're cooking tonight.
Sure, Kat. Hi, my name's Jodine and I am in Karaka in this lockdown. And this is my Thermi with this little friend beside him. I'm very, very lucky to have two on my bench. And we use them every day. I heard about Thermomix in September last year, And so my husband liked to have one, but I didn't want to buy one. So I
Oh, hang on for me 1 second, Jodine. I'm going to see if I can find the person who did not mute themselves and I can mute them. Because they are out there somewhere and there is a lot of you on here. So I just got to do a little search. Okay. Wait, I think I found them. Have I found them? Let me check. Okay, keep going, Jodine.
Fantastic. So tonight I am going to do the cauliflower and ricotta pizza base with blue cheese, pear, and prosciutto. So I put on the poll that I was going to be naughty, but I did get given this one. But we do like cauliflower rice, so let's give it a try. I've done a couple of sets beforehand just to make it go through a little bit quicker. So we're just going to press start cooking. It is now, this is making the ricotta first. So I have pre-made the ricotta. It's 1,800 grams of full cream milk, and then you heat that for 15 minutes at 80 degrees. Then you just have to add 80 grams of white vinegar, and it heats again for another 7 minutes at 90 degrees. And then you end up with a beautiful ball of ricotta cheese. So that was drained in a nut milk bag that is sitting here, and you don't squeeze it because then it will go hard if you squeeze it. So we're only using 80 grams of that ricotta cheese. So that is, the rest is going to be spinach and ricotta cannelloni tomorrow night.
I love it. So in the chat box, guys, who's made ricotta? And if you have made ricotta, what did you use it for? Because there are a few really amazing recipes for using up that ricotta. And what have you got there, Jodine?
This is the ricotta whey. So you end up with obviously this lovely byproduct, which is very high in protein. So I'll be using this when I do baking and use it instead of water. If I was doing a risotto, I will use it instead of the stock water and things like that to use it up. I also did another search that wasn't on the Thermomix site, and I found a ricotta whey caramel. So that's coming out in me. So I'm going to try some caramel with some of that too.
Ooh, I would love to hear how that goes, Jodine. Another great way to use it, guys, is just pop it in smoothies. You know, anything, you can boil your rice and it just whatever, whenever you want to give it a little bit of a protein boost. Now, somebody has asked whether you can make vegan ricotta. Now, Esther, one of our team leaders is on, and she is actually vegan herself. And so maybe vegan Esther can answer that question in the chat box, because I have no idea.
I wouldn't know either. So just a little note, it actually made 360 grams of ricotta. And yeah, we're only going to use 80 grams of that tonight. So that was, 1,800 grams of milk to make 360 grams of ricotta, just in case anyone's interested.
So I did pop the recipe link, the cookie do link in the chat box, if you guys scroll up a little bit, in case you do want to save this to a planner or to a collection.
Fantastic. So then that needed to sit in the bowl for 2 minutes, and it separated out. Line the simmering basket with the nut milk bag and then allow to drain for 30 minutes. Set it aside, clean the bowl, which I already did. Preheated the oven to 200 degrees, so that's the next step. And then it is lining that baking tray with baking paper. Instead, I used my rose gold baking tray with the silicon liner, and that is going to work for me fantastically. So I'll put that aside.
So someone's asking about the dinging. Yes, every time somebody comes in, it goes ding. So you are not going crazy. Okay, there is a little ding. It means people are joining us.
The next step is 500 grams of cauliflower cut into small florets. So I've actually already put that in the bowl. 500 grams of it. I weighed it in using the scales that are on the front. Then we're going to cut that on speed 5 for 4 seconds.
The cauliflower rice is kind of rice. So what other things do you do with cauliflower rice? Hit me in the chat box, guys.
We use a lot of it just steamed like that instead of normal rice. And we'll steam it a bit further and then mash it as cauliflower rash. It's really bad.
Guys, for those of you who don't know, I also do Olympic weightlifting, and when I cut weight to get down a body weight class, I have been known to use it instead of oats and then like bake it and make like cauliflower oats. And Mr. Thermodad is always like gagging in the corner when I'm eating my, you know, oats with peanut butter and almond milk, and it's, yeah, I wouldn't recommend it unless you have to.
Let's not do that.
No.
So then we're spreading it onto the baking tray, and then it goes into the oven for 15 minutes at 200 degrees, stirring every 5 minutes to ensure it doesn't burn. So I've actually done some ahead of time, and what that has done to it is dried it out slightly, so it's not going to be so wet in the mixture that we're making next.
And I think, guys, the thing is, you got to watch it, right, and turn it, because it can catch, and you don't want burnt cauliflower pizza. Diane has said she made the John Dorian cauliflower couscous with corn puree for dinner. That's one of Mark Southern's recipes, and that is a delicious recipe. So, total gourmet.
So then it says rinse and dry the mixing bowl. So I'm just going to transfer, because I can, to the other bowl.
Love it.
Reduce the oven temperature to 180. Then we're going to do 80 grams of Parmesan cheese. So this is going to make the cauliflower base. So we're doing the Parmesan cheese cut in two pieces. And then this is going to cut it up. So I'm just going to show you, this is about the size that I put it into. And 10 seconds at speed 9. And you're going to hear the power, because it's going to hear my sound.
I love it. Listen to the power, guys. Okay. Parmesan cheese is pretty hard, and the bowl is stainless steel. So it is going to be really powerful. But you'll notice that it's only a few seconds of that very powerful sound, and then it actually starts to break down the Parmesan. So Esther's just found a vegan ricotta, and it's made from almonds, coconut cream, lemon juice, vinegar, garlic. Ooh, look at that. That's finely grated. Nutritional salt. That's amazing, Esther. You might have to go have a go at making it.
Then next, we're going to add the cooled cauliflower.
Love it.
We're going to add in one egg, proudly made by my chickens.
I love that. You'd be happy to have chickens at the moment, because my countdown's a little low on eggs.
Yes, yes. When I went to the supermarket today, it would have been slim pickings. 80 grams of the reserved ricotta. So I already weighed that out as well to save a bit of time. Whoops. Oh, yeah. And put the lid on. And that's going to mix for 6 seconds at speed 6.
So this is a very good option if you are on that low carb or keto lifestyle, because, you know, we still want pizza, right? And I have heard that this is very delicious, so it's a good one.
Is this the same one that Amber made last time?
She made the fathead pizza dough, so it was a different one. So that was why I wanted to make sure that it was something else, so that we weren't just repeating ourselves, because I know we have some people who come often, which we love. We love having the people who are our regulars. That looks amazing.
So it's still quite a wet. I think I'm more going to be spreading it. It's almost like a mashed cauliflower.
Yep.
So scrape down the sides, put the lid back on, and it's speed 6 again for 6 seconds. And then it says, spread the cauliflower mixture into lined baking trays, forming one large or two smaller pizzas. So my oven is not got fan bake, so I am going to do two just so that I can spread them out. And I am using the rose gold pizza tray just with some baking paper to go on each of them. Mm-hmm. So after that, it is bake for 20 to 25 minutes, 180 degrees until lightly golden. So I will spread these out. It's actually a lovely...
Ooh, looks great.
Almost like mashed potato, but a bit drier. And I'll get Steve-O to spread those out, I think. And then we'll come back to you once they're cooked.
So what I'm doing is I'm adding spotlights. So when you've spread them out, you can just walk back and show us. But in the meantime, I've gone over to Michelle. So Michelle is, she is losing her voice just because, you know, she's been talking so much and doing all the things. And so if she's a bit croaky, I'm going to hop in and save her. But I am going to let her introduce herself and let us know what she's cooking. And so I might be talking a lot more for Michelle. Oh, we got no sound from you.
Is that better?
That's better. I was like, you're not that. I mean, that was, you know, no, I know you've got no voice, but we're not that bad.
Yeah, sorry about that. So, I am sounding a little bit horrible, but I'm Michelle. I've been with Thermomix almost 3 years now, and I'm a team leader for the Southeast Auckland area. I'm excited to see some of my customers on here tonight, so thanks for joining. And welcome to my kitchen. My husband has decided it's time to make himself some dinner whilst he's been working in the garden with the boys. So there'll be lots happening in my kitchen. And my machine has decided to turn itself off. So I am making a summer crumble, summer fruit crumble. And the fruit I'm using is, because I didn't have fresh fruit, I was also wanting to make what's available in my pantry. So I'm using frozen blueberries, frozen strawberries, and chopped apples, and that I'm going to make a beautiful coulis. So serving it as a nice dish, I'm going to make a beautiful coulis, serve it with some coconut yogurt.
Fantastic. And so, guys, the thing, especially during lockdown, is we may not all have the ingredients that the recipe calls for. Sometimes you got to be creative, right? So as Michelle said, she doesn't have fresh berries. That's okay. No sweat. Frozen berries and apples. What other fruits could we use, though? If we don't have berries and we don't have apples. Oh, that's looking good, Jodine. Looks great. Into the oven for baking for 25 minutes. So if we didn't have apples and we didn't have frozen berries, what could we use? Pop it in the chat box. Nicole likes crème anglaise, me too. Yeah, peaches, Sarah, that's right. What else? Rhubarb, yep, I love it. Is it rhubarb season at the moment? Possibly, some people have rhubarb in their garden. Pears, yep, definitely pear season. I love it.
Right, so to start with a dish, I've got 200 grams of strawberries that were frozen, I've just defrosted them, and I have popped some dust. Well, I wish you wouldn't be it right now.
I do love, you know, working from home. Our families are definitely part of our Thermomix business. And yeah, mine's the same. I've always got children hanging. So you might see a little ghost arm coming out of my background at some point as they try and grab me.
Right. So all I'm going to do now is I'm going to put some unsalted butter, because that's what I've had. 30 grams of that into my bowl. I'm going to put the apples. And some black berries. And 367 grams of blackberries. I just kind of jumped in there in my hand, really. So 100 grams of golden caster sugar. Now, I don't know if you can see it really well, but I never buy this stuff, and it is a little bit more expensive than the other, but this is just raw sugar that's been milled for 7 seconds on speed 6 to make the delicious golden caster sugar. So pop the lid on, and that's going to cook now for 10 minutes.
So if you missed that, what Michelle has put in there, some frozen berries, some apples cut into pieces. They do need to be peeled. A little bit of butter. some amaretto. Now, if you don't have amaretto, what else could you use, guys? Any alcohol, you know, you could go with a Contreau. You could, I don't know, what else would you use? Pop it in the chat box. And then she has put some golden caster sugar in there. If you want it to be really, really nice and not naughty, you could substitute that for some sort of sweetener. And what she's going to do now is she is cooking it down for 10 minutes at 100 degrees on just spoon speed, which is just the stirring. And so while that's happening,
I haven't included the strawberries, so the strawberries are kept out, and these are the ones that are soaking when they look here.
Fantastic. And so what we're going to do is we're going to head over to Lisa. Now, Lisa is making the naughty pizza. And so I've just got to find her so I can spotlight her. There she is. Lisa, tell us about your pizza.
I am going to make a pan pizza, so like a deep dish one. I am doing it in a skillet, like the recipe asks for as well, which I've never done before, so this will be interesting. But it sounds really yummy, and the recipe itself has the dough and the sauce and chopping the cheese and everything all in one, so it's a good one if you want someone who needs all the instructions and stuff as well. Do you want me to get going?
Yeah, go for it. Did you tell us a little bit about you?
I didn't, but I can.
Yeah, we'd love to know. We'd love to. I mean, I know most people know you, but for those who don't know you, can you introduce yourself, please?
Sure. I am Lisa. I live in Waiuku, and I have a team of consultants in Franklin and South Auckland. And Thermomix changed my life. So did Thermomix in lockdown last year. Now it's the only thing I do. I shut down my business because I loved it so much and I love helping people. So yeah.
Lisa is also involved in a pilot program building a virtual team in New Zealand. So we know, especially in these days and ages, there's some people who don't want to leave their house and do stuff. And so if all you want to do is be in a virtual space, then Lisa is actually your girl to talk to because she is able to support you virtually. What you got there, water?
Yep. So we're just popping in 9.5 ounces. So this recipe is from America and the machine has converted to ounces for us, so we don't really have to do any of the thinking. We're going to go in with a teaspoon of yeast and a pinch of sugar, so I've got all that there, and you just want to make sure that you pop it in the water around the blades, not on top of the blades, so that it can all mix in together and activate. And I don't know if you can tell, but I'm doing it in a dirty bowl because I have already made a dough, and I don't like planning my bowl if I don't have to.
That is totally my favorite instruction when it says, do not clean bowl. And my heart does a little happy dance. I love it.
Definitely. So I have used normal tap water because I'm not very good at working out lukewarm water myself. So I'm actually just going to turn it up from 20 seconds to 2 minutes. I'm setting it for 100 degrees Fahrenheit, which is pretty close to 37 Celsius. And I'm just going to put that on for 2 minutes so that it can warm up for me. And it takes the guesswork out of it so I don't have to try and get the perfect temperature of water as well.
Fantastic. Now, pizza dough is by far one of the most versatile recipes we have on Cookie Doo. It's probably my favorite thing to make. What are some of the things that you make with pizza dough, Lisa?
We do scrolls. Is it calzones? Those ones where you like fold the little pockets.
Yep. Seal them.
You can do rolls, like little dinner rolls with it. So many different things. And obviously, depending on how thin you roll it or thick you do it as well, it depends on the kind of texture that you get once it's baked as well.
I'm lucky enough to have Asian team leaders and consultants in my branch, and they use the pizza dough for steamed pork buns. Diane just said she made Sylvia steamed pork buns and they were great. She also uses the dough for bao buns. It is a very, Sylvia says, what's it called? The master dough. Is that what she calls it?
Yeah.
The super dough. I don't know. She calls it something cool. It sounds much cooler when Sylvia says it. When I say it, it sounds a bit naff. Super dough.
She did one time on one of our classes online, she did the coriander pizza where it was all folded in and fried in a pan. Do you remember that?
I do.
It was delicious.
She also, what Sylvia does is she rolls it out and she pops, she spreads miso paste over the pizza dough, sprinkles chopped onions, and then puts some cheese, grated cheese, and she rolls that up and cooks that as like an Asian pancake. And it sounds like it would not be good, but it is literally delicious. So definitely something that you want to try. Miso, onion, cheese.
I think it sounds like it would be yum because miso is quite salty, yeah?
Yeah, definitely. Umami, yeah. That's the word, right? It's umami. Yeah.
So I had about 20 seconds left of my 2 minutes left before I could see the little number above the number I was aiming to get to turned on. So I know that it's at the right temperature now. So I've just stopped it so we can carry on. And then we're going to go in with 14 ounces of bread flour, also known as baker's flour. I'm making a terrible mess. Or in our supermarkets, you'll probably see it as high-grade flour.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you can see it, because newsflash, well, yeah. It's gone.
Yeah, yeah.
All the flour is gone.
The little label will still be there, but the shelf may be empty.
Yeah.
So into that, we're going to pop in 2 teaspoons of olive oil. I am not a measurer, as you can probably tell, so I'm just winging that. We're going to go in with some, it says sea salt. I've got a little bit of man grind, so it's got some herbs and chili and garlic and stuff in that as well. So that'll just add to the flavor.
Love it.
And then we're going to pop it on and it's going to knead away for 2 minutes for us.
I love it. And so guys, you know, don't leave your Thermomix when it's kneading. Don't walk away. It does move around a bit. And you know, if it falls on the floor at the moment, Roger is not up at the service center to fix it for you. So that's all I'm saying. We are delivering Thermomixes in lockdown level 4, but we can't fix them. So just be looking after it. That's amazing. Now this is, as we were saying, we wanted to give you something different to just the regular pizza dough. So that's why we went for kind of that deep dish pan pizza. And I'm really excited to see it cooked in a skillet. As Lisa said as well, you do grate the cheese in the Thermomix and you make the sauce and all that sort of stuff. So yeah, we just thought it might be nice for something different. Lisa mentioned because she did pre-make a batch of dough. You said you didn't think it was as good as the normal pizza dough.
Oh, it's, I don't know if as good is the right thing to say. It's different. It's definitely like softer, squishier. Yeah. But yeah, it's we've used half of the pre-made one that I made earlier for the kids' dinner so that I had something for them. And yeah, it was quite nice. They liked it. So, I mean, the dough is just a bit different to, I think I would still probably do the pizza dough.
It's and I guess that's the thing, right? We guys, I don't know about you guys, but I fall into the habit of finding a recipe that I really like and then just not cooking anything else. So it's quite good when you get, you know, forced out of your comfort zone a little bit, I feel like. Yeah. So Lisa, you are running a dough workshop on Sunday and Michelle has been running a daily dough workshop. So Michelle's, they tend to be 30 to 45 minutes long. So that's quite great if you want to hop on at 4 p.m. and just kind of get a short, sharp hit of Thermomix inspiration. We ran one yesterday, one today, and then we'll be starting them back up on Monday. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Lisa's doing a longer class kind of like this on Sunday. So you've got, you guys are spoiled for choice for classes at the moment. It's very exciting.
So there, that is our dough all finished. It is definitely stickier. If anyone's made the pizza dough, it kind of is a little bit smoother at this point and it is pulled away from the edges, and this one is sticking just a little bit, but it is still nice when it's baked. So this is the one that I made earlier, which I have knocked down recently and rolled back into a ball. So that is that one there. I'm actually just going to pop it into my skillet so that I can get that ready to go in a second.
I do love baking or cooking in a skillet because I feel like it's that gorgeous presentation, right? When you bring the skillet out and then it's, you know, pretty.
Definitely. So we're going to give our blades a little bit of a wiggle and that will help our dough just to drop out like that. Then we've got a little bit left in there, so I'll pop it back on. If you go to the little house on your screen, that'll take you home, and then you can go to all your functions. I'm just going to put it on turbo just for a second, just to blitz everything out to the sides.
Such a great tip. I love that one. I don't like to waste anything.
I don't have a spatula out. Please ignore my Christmas one that I'm going to use, because I was not pre-organized with having a spatula.
I feel like nobody can judge anybody in lockdown. We're all just doing the best we can with what.
Not at all. So it's spat those bits out to the side so that we can get everything, which is good. There's no waste. And this tip works for any kind of dough. I like that with things like cookie dough, you get like a whole extra cookie by doing this. So it's definitely handy. There you go. And if you get a little bit of dough and use that dough, it will actually pull the dough out of the bowl for you as well. It'll stick to the little bit of dough that you do have. All right, so I'm just going to wrap that up, and then that is going to prove away. I don't know what I'm going to do with that at this point, but we'll figure something else out to do with it.
Do you reckon you could tint it and make rainbow bread with that, or do you reckon it's not the right sort of dough?
No, I think it's probably not the right sort of dough. I think you need like a nice one that's going to fill a tin. So it's probably not enough dough.
Yeah.
The dough itself would probably be fine.
Yeah.
So we're just going to let that rise. Do you want me to carry on?
Yeah. So Nicole is saying, I think Nicole, are you asking? So we did turbo to flick the dough up. I think Nicole missed that bit because she was dealing with children. Lisa, I'm going to get you just to hold for me for 1 second, because it looks like Michelle has got that fruit ready to go. And she's currently, if I can read her mind, I'm trying to read her mind. I think she's actually going to serve the fruit and put a dollop of coconut yogurt onto it. And show us the nice. Yep, that's exactly what's going to happen.
That's what's going to happen. What I have discovered using frozen fruit is it has a lot of water content. And so what I have had to do is pop some corn flour into it. And I'm just thickening it up for another minute or so and cooking that to make it nice.
Excellent. So I'll leave you to do that, and while that happens, Lisa is obviously getting her dough into the deep dish, and she's going to keep going with the cheese and the sauce.
Yeah, so I've just popped that in. In the recipe it specifically says to this is a couple of steps ahead, but I'm just doing that so that I'm ready. It says to use your fingers just to smudge it out, and then just pop it up the side just a tiny little bit. So we're going to put some nice sauce and stuff in there. So just pop that over to the side. And then what we are going to do is it wants 6 ounces of low moisture mozzarella. And I don't know about you guys, but I did not have low moisture mozzarella just sitting in my fridge. So I just have a random mix of all the cheeses that we did have. So we've got some Colby, a little bit of Tasty, and then, lost that bit on the floor, and a little bit of Parmesan.
Do you have the 3 second rule in your house? Because we totally, if the dog doesn't eat it, it's good to go back in the bowl.
Should I like out myself? I don't know if I want to eat off my floor right now.
I love it. I love your honesty.
I'll be honest. I don't know if I want to eat off the floor right now. So we'll just skip it. Hey, it is 5.6 ounces and we only need 6. So we're close enough.
Perfect.
So I'm just going to give it a blitz just for 5 seconds. We're going to go to speed 6.
So grating cheese in the Thermomix, pretty much the best thing ever. I don't know about everybody else. I always break my fingers when I try to use a grater. So I'm all about the grating the cheese.
Here we go.
Yay.
All chopped up for us. So I'm going to pop it into my bowl that I had my flour in just to save some dishes. And I've also put that straight into the bowl that I had my dough in as well. So it's kind of got dough and cheese in it now, and I'm also going to crack straight into the sauce into that same bowl too. So we're going to do 3.5 ounces of yellow onion. Is that a brown onion in New Zealand? That's what I've gone with.
So.
And 2 cloves of garlic. Well, I've gone with 3.
Yeah, you measure garlic with your heart, guys.
And there were 3 quite big ones as well.
Yeah. I feel like that must be like some, you know, guard against COVID as well, right? Garlic must be, like, you know,
I don't know if
strengthen
that's
your immune system or something.
We'll go with that. There's a teaspoon of teaspoon of oil, and then I'm just going to chop it 5 seconds, speed 5.
Excellent. So speed 5 is the chopping speed. So if you are going to chop onions or, you know, any salads, coleslaws, beetroots, things like that, you're going to use speed 5.
So one of my favorite things of a Thermomix is never having to chop onions or garlic again, especially so you don't get the smell on your hands. So that's all chopped up. I'm going to give everything a bit of a scrape down. Just ignore this not Thermomix spatula. And then it's going to cook away 4 minutes, 212 degrees Fahrenheit. And it's just going to go speed 1. So for 4 minutes, it's going to cook.
I don't know what that is in degrees Celsius. Like, we're just...
No idea.
No idea. Great. So let's go back over to Michelle and see what that compote looks like. Oh, you're on mute. I'll get you to unmute before you talk.
Sorry.
Perfect.
So that's come out really nicely, and that's a beautiful thing about guided cooking. It is just a guide. So looks good and smells really delicious. So now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pop some into our breakfast glass like that. I love sauce. Berries and sauce are just good. Can you see that? It
looks delicious.
I am making one for my husband, so 2 of us. And then the rest
is going to be naughty.
It's going to be naughty. So I'll pop that. And then we do have the strawberries that have been marinated in the liqueur. So maybe just a little bit for our breakfast.
At the moment, with the current state of things, I feel like a little bit of alcohol with
breakfast is
possibly a good idea. Yeah. It's medicinal.
It's helpful. Very helpful. So I've just popped that in there, give it all a mix, and then I'm going to put it into this bowl here. I'm so sorry.
It's okay. So yeah, the nice ones, they're just going to have a dollop of coconut yogurt. And what Michelle is doing with the rest of that fruit is she's going to continue with the actual recipe, and she's going to do the naughty version, the decadent and delicious one.
Yeah, and it looks really nice. It makes quite a good amount. I wasn't sure at first. I thought it was quite a small recipe, but that's quite a nice sized pie dish that I've filled. Right. And... For nights, we're going to pop some delicious yogurt. This is coconut yogurt, just on the top. And I've got some nuts that I grated up. Where did I put them? Nuts and sesame seeds that I chopped up. And I'm going to sprinkle on the top. So that's all nice for our option. Right, so going through, do you want me to continue this?
Yes, please. I'll get you to make the crumble. Sorry. It only takes a few seconds, and then we'll go back to Lisa.
Yeah, so for our crumb, we're going to be using some nuts. And again, use what you've got in your pantry, and that's the beauty of this recipe. So 50 grams hazelnuts. I don't have hazelnuts, but I did have some walnuts, so I'm popping those in. And next, 50 grams of almonds, so popping those in. And we're going to give that a quick whisk to make some flour for
2 seconds, speed 7.
2 seconds, speed 7.
So basically just giving them a little bit of a chop, the nuts. And yeah, as Michelle said, use whatever nuts you got, right? We're not being fussy during lockdown. We want to avoid going to the countdown as much as is humanly possible.
Isn't that incredible? 2 seconds. Look at that. It's so good. Such a nice crumb. So that's 2 seconds. 3 seconds. Now I'm adding flour. And because I want to eat this, I'm using gluten-free flour. And I'm just subbing exactly the same amount. Because it's a crumble on top, you don't need to worry about it not having the gluten and the elasticity, etc. I'm also popping in some oats, 50 grams of rolled oats, gluten-free ones, and some more caster sugar that I milled earlier, and 100 grams of unsalted butter. Now, this is going to be interesting because can you believe it? It's the one thing I did not panic buy, butter. And
oops.
And when I went to reach up where I normally have 6 or 7 blocks, I'm like, oh my gosh, there's nothing there. So I'm trying it with my olive oil. We'll see what happens. I think it'll be okay. 5 seconds on speed 5, just to combine it.
So Paula is asking whether you made the coconut yogurt.
What was that?
Paula said, did you make the coconut yogurt?
No, unfortunately not. I have made coconut yogurt before, and it's beautiful, but no, that one I didn't make. I should have lied, but I don't.
That's okay. We like it when you keep it real. You could pretend you made it, but we're all real here. So,
here's my crumble. Great. It's looking good. I kept my margarine in the fridge until the very last minute. And I think that's what helped, just to try and, you know, so you, when you're cutting in with butter, you've got something to work again with margarine, which is really mushy because of...
I reckon you could probably use coconut oil if it was in the solid state. Maybe that would, I don't know, like butter's always better, right? So oats actually naturally are gluten-free, but sometimes they get cross-contaminated when they are produced. So somebody was just asking about gluten-free oats. If you are celiac, you need to hunt out gluten-free oats. But you're not celiac.
3 hour countdown.
Yeah. So you're not celiac. You just avoid gluten because it doesn't agree with you.
Yeah, exactly right.
So Michelle is popping that crumble over, and then she is going to put the crumble into the oven at 200 degrees Celsius for 20 to 25 minutes. While she's doing that, let's flick back over to Lisa, who is, oh, you know, she's back, and she can keep going with her sauce.
My phone's dying, so hopefully that doesn't happen too, just to add to all of the extra realism we're doing. So I am going to pop in, I assume, how normal cans are a 12-ounce can of tomatoes. I don't know.
Sure.
We'll soon find out. Oh, there you go. 13.5. So a little bit extra. It is asking for crushed tomatoes, and I have done diced. So I'm going to just really quickly give it a little blitz. I don't know, like speed 5 until I think it's done.
I'd go 5 seconds speed 5, I reckon, something like that. When it cooks down, it is, I think, naturally also going to break down a little bit, which will be good.
I think 3 is going to be good. It sounded about right.
Yeah.
So that's what it looks like now. So it has crushed it all up nicely for us. So let's go back to my recipe. It did ask for button mushrooms, but we need to do a fruit and veggie shop because we literally have the tiniest little iceberg lettuce in our veggie drawer. That's all we have. So we're skipping that. And then it also asked for some dried basil, oregano, rosemary, and a pinch of chili. So I've just got like a mixture of dried herbs and chili flakes there. Then with the simmering basket on this time, we're going to pop that back on and it's going to cook away. So for 5 minutes, 212 degrees again. We are doing reverse speed. I assume that's because of the mushrooms, the sliced mushrooms. So they probably want to keep them reasonably whole. So we don't need to worry about that so much this time. But yeah, speed one, 5 minutes.
Fantastic. And so I'm going to introduce you now to Hayley. So Hayley, little introduction, and then you can let us know what you're going to be making tonight.
Cool. Hi, everyone. I'm Hayley, and I'm in Morrinsville in the Waikato. So I have a team kind of spread all over the Waikato now, and I joined Thermomix in June of last year. So I think we were in like level three at the time. So joined to earn my machine, said I was going to leave once I'd earned it. And here I am a year later, still going, and now I have a team. So like a lot of the other team leaders, it's just so much fun. I really, really enjoy it. So yeah, still here. Can't get rid of me.
We'll never get rid of you.
I hope not. So I'm making the turkey burgers with caramelised onion and capsicum. However, we're making them as chicken burgers because getting a hold of turkey in New Zealand is obviously not the easiest, especially in a small town in a lockdown. So, cool. So I've just got wholemeal bread. I just use the crust, which I normally chuck out because nobody in our house eats it. So we've got 60 grams of that. And then it asks for a whole lot of fresh herbs. So it wants fresh rosemary, fresh sage, fresh thyme, and parsley. But I don't have any fresh herbs at the moment. So I've just used a mixture of whatever dried green herbs that I had. And then we're going to pop the lid on, and it's just going to whiz that for 10 seconds on speed 7.
So we are making breadcrumbs at the moment. So that's another thing that you do not need to buy anymore when you have a Thermomix. And I love that Hayley's just subbed in whatever herbs she has, because guys, we're in lockdown. Like, we just got to do what we can. So don't worry about making it too perfect at the moment. You know, you just got to do what you got to do. Yeah. Ooh, looks good.
Fine breadcrumbs. So I'm just popping that aside for now.
So I will pop the link to the turkey burgers up in the chat box in a second. Let me just get it for you on Cookie Doo.
So I've just got 90 grams of brown onion, which I've cut in halves. And then, so it's just going to blitz that for 3 seconds on speed 7.
So that link is in the chat box for you now. I'm also going to post a link to the brioche burger buns, which is part of the naughty version of this recipe.
And I'm just going to add those breadcrumbs back in. Yeah, I made the brioche buns earlier today and they came out perfect.
It's totally my favorite brioche bun recipe. Such a good one.
Such a good one, yeah. So with the chicken, I had some chicken breasts, so I just pop them in the freezer for half an hour and then cut them into pieces and chuck them up and mince them myself, because it's a lot cheaper to mince your own chicken breast than it is to buy readily minced chicken.
Mince, what did you do? Did you just pop it in and do turbo a few times?
I did turbo. I think I did it 3 times for a second, and that was enough. And an egg.
So the egg is there to bind the burgers, as is the breadcrumbs.
Yep. And then so the next one is a pinch of salt and black pepper, which is here actually. And lid back on. And that's just going to mix for 5 seconds on speed 5.
Looking good. So for us, normally when we're going to have fake away in my house, we'll go for burgers. I love burger fake away. And yeah, guys, at the moment, no one's getting any real takeaway. So we just got to look after ourselves at the moment. might be a while.
So that's just our burger mixture ready to go. So that's just asking me to shape that now. So do you want me to move on to the caramelized onions?
And yeah, just I'll get you to chuck the onions on, and then while the onions are cooking, you can start shaping the patties. And what I'll do is I'll just leave you spotlighted so we can watch you, but you don't have to talk and we can let somebody else cook.
So it asked me to clean and dry the mixing bowl, but, you know, two bowls, so.
Yay.
The best thing. So in here, I've got 500 grams of onion. Now, it asked me to chop them in eighths. I'm not a maths person, so I just chop them small. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's close enough. So I've got that and a whole capsicum chopped up as well. And then 2 tablespoons of brown sugar, and then in this one I've got 40 grams of butter, salt, and 2 tablespoons of balsamic vinegar. And that's just going to cook away for 10 minutes on Baroma on just the stirring speed.
Fantastic. So I'll let you start shaping the patties. As you shape them, can you hold them close to the screen so we can actually see them? And then I think Lisa is actually ready. Are you ready, Lisa, to show us your pizza?
I can. I put it on, there was 40 seconds left. I put it on for an additional 2 minutes because I had time. So I just did.
Love it.
So if you have a Thermomix, if you have a TM6, you'll know that it does a cool down. So because I pushed it, it's done a 20 second cool down. So I'll just wait for that to open up.
This is a safety feature, guys. So if the temperature is below 80 degrees, there's no cool down. Then between 80 and I don't know what the other one is. Sorry, it's left my mind. It does an 8 second cool down. And then over a certain temperature, it will do a 20 second cool down before it opens.
So it says to set the sauce aside and then to transfer your dough. I just wanted to say, so the herbs that I put in my sauce were Italian Stallion from Pepper and Me. So I literally used the last of my jar. So I thought, why don't I use this jar to put the other half of the sauce in that I'm not going to use? So I'll just pop that on there. It's actually the perfect fit for Pepper and Me jar.
I love it.
I'm going to put about half of that in. Yeah, that's about half. And then me pop that back in there. And I'll pop the lid on. And then they can cool down and I can use that on a pizza another time. And it's just going to get all the last little bits of the herbs in there as well, which is not going to do any harm to it. So it says to transfer the dough now to your skillet, shape it, and then it says to cover it and leave it for 15 minutes, which has probably been since I did it, maybe even a little bit longer. And then it says that you want to use your fingers, push it up the edge of the pan a little bit, leave it for 15 minutes, preheat your oven, which I've also done, 500 degrees Fahrenheit.
What's that?
So I just asked my husband to Google it for me. 260, our oven does not go that high, so we're on 250.
That seems really high. Those Americans always trying to push the limits of what is possible.
Definitely. So what I'm going to do is says to divide the sauce between the 2 different pizzas. So I'm going to pop this other half of it on. Give it a good scrape and get with all your goodness
Christmas
out.
Scraper.
It's always Christmas. Oh, I wish it was always Christmas. I did see a meme on Facebook that said maybe we should just put our Christmas trees up and call it a year.
Yeah, I feel like that's not a bad idea. It's actually great timing because I can see down the bottom that Jodine's pizza is also ready for the toppings. That's looking great, Jodine. Looks awesome.
So remember that this would have the mushrooms in if we put that in, but it is just like a pizza sauce at this point. And you can also put, the recipe says capsicum and pepperoni, but obviously you could top it with whatever you want. I'm going to go with straight cheese because we're actually having ours as a side with soup, just being extra bougie, having pizza on the side of soup.
I love it.
So I'm just going to pop that, about half of that on top.
Mm, so now, with some people are saying how good your pizza base looks, Jodie, the cauliflower pizza base. It really does. It looks amazing.
It smells divine.
Yeah, I'm actually going to make this one, I reckon.
Yeah.
So, Lisa, you're going to bake in a fire that is as hot as hell.
Yeah.
For how many minutes?
We're going to go for, and I also just put all the cheese on, even though I've done half the sauce, I did all the cheese. For 15 to 20 minutes.
Fantastic.
So this is my before. I don't know how long we're going to be on. This is my before, but I'll take photos if we're done before it's done.
So yeah, if we are done before it comes out, we'll just pop them in the event. Right, Jodine, what are you putting on that pizza?
Oh,
nope. Dropped your phone.
Oops. The phone just fell down in the hole. Right. Hopefully we'll stay. So. Next is brush the pizza bases. I'm off mute, aren't I? Yes.
Yes, you are.
So brush the pizza bases with oil.
Yep.
So I'm just using a light vegetable oil just so that it's not too strong in taste. And then it says sliced pear, blue cheese, and prosciutto.
Ooh.
Quite nice.
This sounds like a bit of me.
Yeah.
So what you can see on the left-hand side of your screen is you can see Hayley has already shaped her chicken burgers, and she is just pan frying them. So yeah, that's what she's got going on. And Jodine is putting pear, prosciutto, and what else are you putting? Rocket.
Blue cheese.
Blue cheese, yum.
And then rocket after it comes out, which I didn't actually, that's one thing I did forget to get, so that we're having... spinach leaves ripped up.
Perfect.
Over the top.
Oh, that looks delicious. Jess, they are fresh pears, aren't they, Jodine? Just sliced.
Yes, they are.
I
didn't have one of those either. So I sent Steve up to his mum's house, which is just up the driveway, and she had a pear for me.
I love it.
Contactless
delivery. So you're going to pop all those toppings on, and then how long does that go in the oven for again?
It goes in the oven for 5 to 10 minutes, just until the cheese has melted.
Fantastic. So while that is happening, I'm going to bring Michelle back onto the screen, and she is going to make the crème anglaise. Oh, now you're muted. There you go. It's okay. And either that or your voice is
It's fine. I was panicking. I was running out of time, so I was
good. All good.
Okay, great. So in my bowl, I have milk. Milk, 5 eggs, and caster sugar.
Fantastic.
And as well as a nice big dollop of vanilla paste. And so this is the best part of making a crème anglaise or a custard. Now, crème anglaise is a French word, and it's for an English, like a runny custard that you serve as a sauce for the dessert. Turn it next, and it's going to go at 80 degrees, and it turns to a mode here, a thickened mode, which means you don't need to do anything. It just works it out how long it's going to cook it for. And so here we go, 10 minutes, it's going to do its thing, and I'm going to 10 minutes to tidy up my kitchen, or set the plates and get ready to have a yummy dessert.
I love that. That's fantastic. Thanks, Michelle. So let's go over to the last person cooking tonight. So Kylie deserves a very special mention. Kylie starts as a consultant tomorrow. So she has very bravely offered to hop on. So welcome to our Thermomix fun hour, Kylie. We're really, really excited to have you start with us tomorrow. I'd love for you just to tell people where you are, why you decided to join the business, and tell them the recipe that you are making.
So, I'm Kylie, and I do start tomorrow, and I'm really, really excited. I am in Massey in Auckland, And I decided to join the Thermomix Fano after I've had my head this since like November, fell in love with it, talk about it all the time. It's the best thing ever. Like it's
we think so.
Yeah. It's changed my life, it really has. So today I'm going to do, or tonight, I'm going to do the pina colada, but I'm going to make it healthy and, naughty and nice. What I've done is I've prepared the nice version with rimming the glass with lemon, and I've used the plate with the for the mini thermoservers to do the rimming. And what I'll do first is I'm going to do the naughty one with sugar. So just a quick rim with a lemon.
Yeah.
And then in the same, perfect size for rimming glasses, these little dishes.
Oh, they're amazing.
So that's really cool.
So that's the naughty one, and the nice one has got just some nice healthy.
They're all ready to go.
I love it. Good. Here we go.
Okay, so I've already got the recipe up. It's already loaded in my week. I have then got the big version of the thermoserver ready with the ice. So it's all hasn't melted, and I've had it sitting here since before we started. So it's all ready to go. I call these magic bulbs. I have told everyone about them. If they don't have a Thermomix, they have to have one of these.
Because you don't need a Thermomix to actually have a thermoserver. You can just, you know, have one anyway.
I have two of these as well, and I still don't know if that's enough, but anyway.
You can never have too many magic balls.
So in goes the ice. And then, obviously, being in lockdown, I want it fresh. I've got tin, so we're going with tin, which works just as well. And I go juice and all.
Yeah. And the great thing about tinned is you don't have to cut it up, right? You just open the can and it's ready to go.
Right in, we're good to go. Now, I've made these for friends at Christmas time and they were delicious. So I can full-heartedly vouch for these. Now, yesterday, good old timing, I ran out of caster sugar. So Thermi came to the rescue because I had normal white sugar, and I've actually milled this up just this afternoon. Okay. Ready for tonight. So that will go in. Now, I've only done 100 grams. It does say 100 to 150. Pineapple's quite sweet. I have to drink this all by myself because no one else drinks in this house. And I decided to reduce the sugar, which is another good thing about our thermomixes.
Yep, sure is.
It goes on.
And basically what is happening there is we are just blending for 2 minutes and we are increasing gradually from speed 5 to speed 10. And so that's just going to blitz that all up beautifully. If you have a TM6, so you could just go into blend mode, but, you know, following the recipe on Cookie Dough is so easy. So what the girls are doing now is they are starting to plate their dishes behind the scenes if their dishes are ready. And the dishes that are ready, we're going to show you what they look like. The pizzas, if they are not quite out of the oven, we're going to post some photos for you. But I know that some of the dishes are coming together. So we're almost at the end, guys. We're about 5 minutes from the end. So you do want to stand so you can see what the dishes look like. We are almost done.
I can hear that's already finished. I've still got about a minute to go, but I can hear that it's all really good.
And you do learn to cook by ear when you have a Thermomix, you know, because you can hear when things are actually ready. So what's going in there now?
The coconut milk.
Yum.
Now. This is where it tells you to add the Malibu, but don't panic. We're just going to skip that bit for a minute. The naughty stuff will come, but I'm just going to mix it in.
Yep.
It's 5 seconds, so this one, that won't take long.
So Vicky, it's good for them to be ice cube size. The Thermomix is very powerful. If the ice cubes are too big, it's not going to kill your Thermomix, but it is hard on your blade. So blades definitely have a lifespan. That lifespan is anything from 6 months to 5 years, depending how much, you know, how hard you are on them. But luckily, blades are only $90 or $100. So, you know, if they do go, it's not the end of the world. Good. So the nice version has got no Malibu in it, and it's going into the cup with the coconut. And then I see you getting ready for the naughty version.
The magic ingredient. So I'm not going to pour the full amount in because there's not as much in here. Plus it's like just me that'll drink this tonight. We'll just pour that back in and mix it up. And I have to admit that one of the reasons I got a Thermomix is that I can do cocktails at home.
I know. The cocktails are pretty good.
I'll out myself with that. So mix it again.
I love it. Nikki, how you will know that your blades need replacing is that they will strip. So one day you will put things to chop into the bowl, and because your blades are not actually strong enough to chop it, the bottom of the blade will actually come apart from the blade, and you'll go, oh, that sounded a bit weird. And you'll see that the blades are not doing anything anymore. And so that's the only time. You don't need to sharpen them, nothing like that. When your blades have had enough, they will strip and you will know. And then you'll just buy some new ones. You can order them from the mix shop. It's not a big deal. Yum. That looks amazing, Kylie.
And then
I love the umbrella. I love it. So that's it, guys. Healthy pineapple smoothie or pina colada, whatever you want. I can see. Thank you, Kylie. That was amazing. You did such a great job for your first time. Good luck for your launch tomorrow. I know you're going to be amazing, and we're super excited to have you on the team.
Thanks.
Okay, Hayley, tell us about your burgers.
So the caramelized onion has still actually got like 6 minutes. It's cooked for 10 minutes, and I had to take the measuring cup out, and it's cooking for another 10 minutes. But, so these are my brioche buns I cooked earlier today. It's very bright, isn't it? But I've got some of the chicken patties are cooked out, and they taste like I've just tasted them. So tasty.
Yeah.
And then the nice version, which will be in a bunnace.
The bunnace.
So I just need to add the caramelized onions when they're done, and probably a bit of sauce or mayo or something, and I think they'll be really tasty.
I love that. So here you go, guys. Turkey or the chicken burgers, either naughty or nice. The brioche is amazing. If you want them to be decadent, you're going to put those caramelized onions and peppers on top, or you can pop it in that healthy lettuce bunnace. That's totally up to you. So Hayley as well, she will take some photos, and we will post those photos in the event so that you can see how it turned out. But I can show you Jodine's pizza because look at that. That looks good. Yum. That I am definitely going to make that, Jodine.
It really looks amazing, and it is actually holding. It's like a pizza base.
I love it.
Yeah.
That looks fantastic. So again, Jodine will take a photo for you, and she will pop it into the event so that you can see exactly what they look like. I'm going to add Michelle quickly. I just want to see how much thickened time she has left on her crème anglaise. 2 minutes. But I see you have some crumble. Oh, you're on mute.
Sorry, it's because I'm using my phone as my sound. It's really disturbing. I forget. So there we go. There's some crumble, but yeah, here's Dan. Oh, you can't really see that.
Yeah. That looks amazing. I love
it.
Yeah,
it's really nice. It didn't need to be thickened. So I'm glad I did that.
Yeah.
It'll be delicious served with this lovely thickening. So I've only got a few seconds left. And then I'm going to pour it into this little thermo jug, which is really, really nice to have. It's like our thermo service, keeps your sauces warm for up to an hour or so. And yeah, really good to have.
So it is a magic jug to go with the magic bowl. Is that what you're saying? I love it. So we are going to watch you pour that crème anglaise when it's finished. Lisa's showing me some pizza dough. What's that looking like?
That's the dough that we put in before, and it was teeny tiny, and now it is exploding in my mat. So it has sat there and risen really nicely. And I have a couple minutes left on my pizza, but I can show you now because it looks pretty bloody incredible.
We'd love to see it. There we go. Michelle is showing us her crème anglaise.
It just works. It's magic on its own. And it's smooth and delicious. Ooh. And beautiful. It smells, you know, that, oh, there's just nothing nicer than this kind of custard smell.
I reckon I'm going to have to make this over the weekend because that looks amazing.
Pop that on there. Oh, ready to go.
Wow, Lisa, that pizza looks amazing. So, Vicky, the recipe is called, let me just go back and check for you. So, the recipe is called Summer Fruit Crumble with Crème Anglaise. Fantastic. So, ladies, those dishes look amazing. Everybody, I hope this has been of service to you. I hope you've enjoyed it. We've really loved cooking for you tonight. You know, sharing our passion and inspiring you. Hopefully you will create some of these at home. And no matter whether your lockdown's going to be naughty or nice, we hope you stay safe and healthy. And while there are so many virtual events happening over the next few days, so please hop onto the Thermomix in New Zealand webpage, hop onto my Instagram, Thermodet, have a look at what we've got coming up because we'd love to be of service to you. So thank you to my helpers for helping me out. Everything looks delicious. Thank you for coming and we will see you again soon.
Glitter all over the room. Pink flamingos in the pool. I smell
that everyone gone? I think everyone's gone. Look, I took...